very good article about stopping this pipeline. And then I've got a Massachusetts Clean Energy and Climate Scoreboard.
How many people here have been to the Statehouse and visited your legislator? How many of you know who Mass Power Forward is? Okay, again, not everybody. So Mass Power Forward is a coalition of over 150 organizations.
So the idea of a green bank is, how do you get the financing to develop technology that's already existing to get all our houses and commercial enterprises turned green, part of a green revolution?
It's pretty simple.
Yeah, well, today the rally is was first organized because there is a hearing by the Senate Committee on global warming and climate change that was scheduled to be about the NED pipeline and our clean energy future. Then the Kinder Morgan announced that they were suspending their pipeline plans, but the committee decided to go ahead with the hearing, and so a bunch of people across the state decided to organize a rally to mark this event, and getting people who are involved in other pipeline fights and other infrastructure opposition, as well as people promoting clean solutions, are all coming together for this rally and this hearing.
The town of Ashfield has adopted a resolution to oppose the pipeline, so I'm here fulfilling that duty as a politician to do that. Fossil fuels need to stay in the ground, and probably for the rest of my life I'll be attempting to make that happen.
I am opposed to the pipeline. I was an impacted landowner. I hope I stays that way. And because I don't appreciate being in the incineration zone, but that's not why I'm on the bus. I'm on the bus because I have grandchildren, and I want their energy future to be clean. I want it to be sustainable. I want them to be able to breathe the air, drink the water, and that's why I'm here. It's to turn the tides on global warming.
I'm on the bus because I'm concerned about the future welfare of generations to come, and the reliance on fossil fuels is, I believe, a genuine threat to quality of life at the most benign interpretation of future events. And so I want to stand up against them, and I want to support the fuels that are renewable and that don't bear with them the kind of toxicity that these other fuels do.
I am not in favor of the pipeline. If we're going to meet our climate goals and if we're going to avert the worst of the temperature rise, then we have to be serious about closing down fossil fuels and conservation and using renewables. If we keep building the infrastructure, then we're not going to meet those goals at all. And I'm on the bus today because it's important for the lawmakers to understand that there is support for this move to reduce fossil fuels, and hopefully with that knowledge they'll do the right thing. They can't be persuaded by the money alone. They have to be persuaded by their moral conscience and the future. If this is a wonderful planet, it's truly extraordinary and perhaps unique in the universe, and so that we're not good stewards of it is such a shame.
I'm very concerned about climate change. I don't think we have a moment to waste, and I feel that it's become a corrupt system. We need to hold our legislators accountable.
I feel pretty strongly against all fossil fuel infrastructure moving forward, and it was obvious from the outset to me that this the damage that could be done with the proposed pipeline was not good for the planet and thereby not good for us.
The more I learned about the last pipeline proposal, the more I found it reprehensible on so many different levels. And I'm here today to show my support for a more renewable energy future.
For me, it's about the children and those to follow. I absolutely think these fights are about, these are lifetime commitments, and they're all about human rights, and they're about the vulnerable and those who are politically powerless, and as I've said before, all the beings who cannot speak for themselves.
It's a whole range of people who are members of different organizations, people from the Berkshires and from the Pioneer Valley and from the North Quabbin area, from Franklin County, from all over, who mostly have been engaged in fighting the Kinder Morgan Ned pipeline, some of us for more than 2 years.
I'm opposed to the pipeline. The pipeline will increase our fossil fuel infrastructure. It's a useless tool. It will be dead in a few years. We don't need $15 billion worth of capital to build a pipeline. Or $5 billion or $3 billion, we need the capital to invest in green infrastructure. I want to hear from the committee, if I can get into the room, what their proposals are for green infrastructure building. I want to know what the proactive, positive direction is going to be.
Specifically in Massachusetts, I think we can be a state that is on the forefront of alternative energy and green energy.
Primarily, I'm against it because I think any fracked gas is detrimental to public health and to the water supply and ruining our woods and our wild areas as well as small towns. I think compressors are their own evil. And of course, I worry about leaks. But I'm on the bus today because I'm involved in Climate Action Now, Mothers Out Front, the Green Group at our South Congregational Church, and as an older woman, I'm really possessed by this climate issue. And we need to do something yesterday, so today is as good as it gets.
Thank you.
Okay, I think she did better than I could possibly do.
We're completely against it. It's not needed. We've been involved with this for about 28 months since we got our first knock on the door. And my first task for me was to figure out, was it really needed or not? I'm a degreed electrical engineer, so I do have some background in some of this. And within 3 or 4 months, I had determined that this pipeline was not needed 2 years ago, certainly not needed now, and it will not be needed in the future. Because there are other means of creating the energy that we need, including hydro, solar, and wind, both on and offshore.
Great. And why are you on the bus today?
We're on the bus to help the folks that could still be impacted by the pipeline should this come back. We were on the original route, and we started this 28 months ago. We want to see this through.
I disliked it being put on water lands, lands that were set aside for aquifers for clean water, and that was my initial reaction to this whole thing. And most importantly, we have an article in the Massachusetts Constitution that prevents people from doing things like this after the people in the region have set aside land in order to be kept safe, not for foolish reasons, but for things like water. And we were going to have an outside company that did not provide energy, it just provided piping, to put a pipe over places that we had set aside from development because it was cheap for them to do that when we already had corridors along I-90 that would have allowed them to do a similar thing just at a higher expense. And there's already piping there. So that was my initial reaction to this whole thing.
There were several issues. Briefly, it's about the money for Kinder Morgan. And they will do anything for the money. They've lied, apparently, and they don't have a good record. The other one is, I think it's against the law in terms of our Constitution, both state and federal. We have certain rights that are in the Bill of Rights that they cannot take things from us. And the other one, basically, it's a moral, ethical environmental and theological issues, since we got so many folks who are religious about things like this, and I'm a retired pastor, I think we do not have the right to destroy our environment, and that's what part of this will do. And the other side of that is, it'll be destroying part of our environment that they don't even understand how much they will destroy.
I've been against the pipeline since I first heard about it 2 years ago. The original route was going to come across the entire Millers River watershed from east to west, 10 towns. And I work for the Watershed Council, and there were so many reasons to be against the project, and not one good reason to be for it. So even though it ended up shifting into New Hampshire a bit, it still runs through the Millers River watershed, and it's such a horrific project on so many levels, and it's just so symbolic of the attempt of people in very high levels of power to ramrod their own interests over the needs of small town people and local people. And so for me, coming today into Boston, this is an opportunity to voice our support for local democracy and people power, and to see if this experiment in democracy that we call the United States can actually have some legs to it and be real.
I'm opposed to the pipeline, and for a few reasons. One of them is because I think it's completely unnecessary, and I think we can all see it's unnecessary because the pipeline company can't get enough contracts to actually pay for the pipeline. So because of that, they're expecting us to pay for the pipeline, which is pretty appalling. It's not going to be our pipeline. And I think the reason for the pipeline really is to carry gas to the coast and to get it over to Europe, where the market is much higher. And very little of that gas is liable to stay here in New England. So all of this to me adds up to a terrible situation for all of us who live here in New England, of putting up with the building of the pipeline and the paying for a pipeline that a private company is going to actually profit from. And it's not going to do us any good. And you know, it's not like necessary critical infrastructure that's actually going to aid us here in New England. So I'm opposed to the pipeline. So I'm on the bus today to announce that to the people in Boston. You know, many of us have developed over the years a relationship with Steve Kulik and Stan Rosenberg and Paul Mark and all of our representatives, Ben Downing, that are wonderful. But they all are politicians, and they really do need our support for them to take what are sometimes dangerous positions for them. And they're hard positions, and so we need to support them to come in and make sure they know that we back them completely.
I'm not sure of too many people who are not opposed to it, where I am anyhow. And for all the same reasons other people are saying, the land itself, the watershed, health, and plus the use of fracked gas. That's a slight side issue. And the reason I'm here today is this is kind of like the final leg of the journey. And my own personal opinion is it's dead because of the larger economic constraints that are going on in the fracking industry and the oil industry. But I wanted to be here for the kind of the last hurrah.
I'm the president of the Pipeline Awareness Network for the Northeast and the Massachusetts Pipeline Awareness Network. There are people here from Climate Action Now and Hilltown Community Rights, North Quadrant Energy, and you know, all the 350 Berkshires. So there's room on the bus for everyone.
I hope.
All right, we're gonna meet back here at 5:15 along here somewhere. Look for bus number 111.
Thank you.
5:15 back here.
I would.
Well, there's a rally with a bit of a celebration. Supposedly there's going to be pizza. And then we're going to head into the State House for this hearing. And there probably won't be room for everybody in the hearing room. So some people will go and lobby either their own legislators or members of the Energy Committee and the Ways and Means Committee, others who need to hear from people from across the state about what our energy priorities are.
No pipelines, go green!
Are you from out this way?
No, I'm from the Adirondacks.
Oh, okay.
So where are you moving to?
Well, we're looking at, where does the...
Hi! How you doing?
So my name is Emily Kirkland. I'm the director of organizing for 350 Massachusetts. We're a statewide volunteer-led climate advocacy group. And I'm here today because we are determined to stop new gas pipelines here in Massachusetts. Today, groups from all over the state, the 150 plus groups that make up the Mass Power Forward Coalition, are gathering for a massive rally to oppose new gas pipelines. Our lawmakers are currently debating a massive energy bill that's likely to pass sometime in the next few weeks or months. We want to make sure that that bill supports clean energy like solar and wind instead of subsidizing unnecessary and dangerous and polluting new gas pipelines.
We are fighting the pipelines for many reasons, not the least of which is that the energy companies have got a scheme to make consumers pay for these pipelines, which we think is very unfair. And there's really no due process, there's no hearing process. They are trying to get consumers to pay for a pipeline that we don't need, we don't want, and will set us back on our climate goals. So those are some of the reasons we're against the pipeline. I can only speak for my group and for me, but people here are against these pipelines because they're going in their backyards. Some are here because they're advocates for renewable energy and this will set us back on that. Some are consumer advocates. Some believe that what they're doing is unconstitutional because they're proposing to put the pipelines into constitutionally protected environmentally sensitive areas. So I think people are here for a large variety of reasons, economic, environmental, and social.
I am absolutely against the pipeline expansion in Massachusetts and the pipeline tax, which would put ratepayers on the hook to pay for that construction. And I am here today because it is, we had one victory and when we saw Kinder Morgan suspend the NED pipeline and we are thrilled about it, but we know the fight's not over and we want our legislators to know we're not going away.
What do we want? Clean energy!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Clean energy!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Clean energy!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Clean energy!
When do we want it? Now!
Good morning, thank you for being here.
My name is Joel Wollen from Clean Water Action. And on my left is Claire Miller from Toxics Action Center, Emily Kirkland from the Better Future Project. We are here, we're gonna MC the event today, but I wanted to say that this is a big coalitional effort. We have people fighting routes of different gas pipelines, people fighting for multiple clean energy industries. We have faith leaders and congregants in our world, and no, we do not want to be subsidizing fossil fuels. We will not. We are not going to invest in frack gas pipelines. We are here to put people above pipe. You're going to hear how those battles are converging into a common common goal, a common policy platform, and a common vision for a clean energy future for our state and region that allows our energy dollars to stay local, that allows people to breathe clean air and drink clean water, that allows us to meet our climate goals.
We're a statewide volunteer-led network fighting for climate justice here in Massachusetts. We're working to divest the state pension fund from fossil fuels so that our state stops investing in the pipeline companies like Kinder Morgan and Spectra that want to bring fossil fuels into our state. We're also fighting to put a price on carbon and to stop pipelines and promote a clean energy future for Massachusetts. And as Joel mentioned, we're here today as part of Mass Power Forward, a coalition of more than 150 groups all over the state. And we know that we need to stand united.
And that's why we've come together today. Over the next few weeks and months, our legislators will debate an energy bill that could determine our future for decades to come. That bill will either subsidize new gas pipelines or will promote solar, wind, and the clean energy solutions we need. And we're here to say no to pipelines. No to pipelines! No to pipelines! We're here to say yes to clean energy. Yes to clean energy! Yes to clean energy!
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Keep on a walking, keep on a talking, walking up to freedom land. Kinder Morgan, ain't gonna let Kinder Morgan turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let Kinder Morgan turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let Spectra Energy turn me around. Keep on a walking, keep on a talking, walking up to freedom land.
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around.
Keep on a walking, keep on a talking, walking up to freedom land.
And it's
the tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. The tide is rising, and so are we. This is where we are called. This is where we are called to be. This is where we are. The task is mighty, and so are we.
The task is changeful.
One thing I have not done this entire time is speak at a rally. I managed to go this far. But thank you to everybody who is involved in any aspect of this broad movement. And I want to especially mention Rosemary Wessel, who is not able to be with us here today. She stayed home in Cummington. But she has, since the very beginning, she founded No Frack Gas in Mass and has been involved with the Pipeline Awareness Network for the Northeast and Mass Plan. And without Rosemary, a lot of us would know a lot less about what is going on. She, and from the very beginning, Rose has made sure that people knew this is not just about one pipeline fight and one company. It's about the overbuild of all this unneeded fossil fuel infrastructure that's just bringing us in the wrong direction. A lot of us know that the NED pipeline has been suspended but not canceled, and so this is a milestone and a victory but not yet a complete victory over that proposal. We need a clean break from that, and meanwhile, a lot of us have also been looking to Sandusfield and Otis State Forest, where Kinder Morgan is still hoping to construct their Connecticut expansion project through protected Article 97 land. And any day now, we are expecting to hear a ruling from the judge in the court in Berkshire County as to whether that Article 97 is preempted by the Natural Gas Act. And I know that he's taking his time, expecting that whatever decision he makes will be appealed. And also, like many of you, we are looking at Spectra and all of the different projects that are going on and fighting this idea of electric ratepayers footing the bill for a build out of gas infrastructure across the region.
Mass Energy is a
a proud partner in the Mass Power Forward Coalition. We support this effort to stop gas pipelines. We are really committed to making sure that Massachusetts realizes its clean energy future, and that we stop talking about it as the future. We make it our clean energy today. And the way we're going to do that is by doubling down on energy efficiency and doubling down on renewables like wind and solar and anaerobic digestion and even some other clean resources that can be done well, and making sure that we replace all these dirty fossil fuels with clean, achievable resources. This is not happening in some far off century. This is happening now in places around the country and around the world. And Massachusetts leadership needs to decide if we want to be leaders and lead by example, or if we want to waste our time playing catch up or even going backwards. And so I am really pleased and proud to be here today with all of you to remind our legislators and remind our regulators and to remind our governor and all these people who are in a position to make decisions on behalf of us, to make the right decision and to make sure that we are talking clean energy today. Not clean energy future, clean energy today. There are many, many reasons why all of you are out here today. Maybe it's because you're a parent. Maybe it's because you have a pipeline that's threatening your community or threatening to decimate your property. Maybe it's because you are looking for jobs and you don't realize that clean energy future actually brings jobs to you, just like dirty pipelines, only better. Whatever the reason, you're here. So let's make sure that they hear us loud and clear when we go in that building today to say, guys, think smart. Think about our future, think about our children, think about our communities. Stop thinking about the unconscionable work of these utilities and start putting people first.
It's in a context that is that not only digestible, but one that really paints a solid picture of where the legislature is coming from on this issue, where Governor Baker and Lieutenant Governor Polito are coming from on this issue. And hopefully, you know, this presentation today leaves you all with a sense of we are well on our way. We are doing everything that we can to move towards a cleaner, more renewable future, but doing it in a smart, economical way that does not have a detrimental effect on our overall economic viability here in the Commonwealth. So how does natural gas fit into this this portfolio of issues that we talked about? It very much does. As I stated before, this is an issue that I cannot stress enough, is that we are becoming, and this is due to market dynamics more than anything else, is we have weaned ourselves off of gas. We have made great steps in trying to get bring closure to natural gas plants. We have pending retirements of nuclear plants. Well, that baseload generation has to come from somewhere. Like we talked about a moment ago, the sun isn't always shining. We cannot depend on solar in moments like right now to produce the baseload energy required to fulfill our needs, to just be able to go to work and go home and turn on our lights. So we need to be cognizant of the fact that we have retired from coal, we are not siting new coal or nuclear plants, and we're becoming more and more reliant on natural gas just to produce that baseload energy. And this slide goes into a little bit of just sort of the process and sort of where everybody fits into the process. And this is one element. This slide is very important because I think this has been missed in a lot of the public dialogue that has occurred. The Federal Energy Regulatory Commission is the sole regulatory entity that reviews and approves interstate gas pipelines, like the pipelines that we have been talking about for the last year and a half now. The Energy Facility Siting Board inside the Department of Public Utilities in this process, in this federally run process, may hold public hearings during the pre-filing and certificate filing phase, submit comments to FERC, and obtain intervener status in the certificate filing phase, all of which it has done and will continue to do in any pipeline siting proposal that occurs inside the boundaries of the Commonwealth. The Department of Public Utilities also reviews the precedent agreements submitted by companies and the survey petitions for access to landowners' property along the proposed route. A little bit more about interstate pipelines. This is the actual process and a little bit of the meat and potatoes around the siting of an interstate pipeline. There's this, once a company does a market analysis and looks to see if additional, if there is market need for additional pipeline capacity, They perform an action called an open season. They have an open season process that really tests, does the market need additional gas capacity? Pipeline companies will do their analysis on the demand and the cost of providing this gas service. And then customers, which would be our LDCs, our local distribution companies, so think of it as our gas entities, or potentially electric distribution companies, will sign and submit precedent agreements to the Duke DPU for approval. Then there's a survey process that needs to occur where pipeline companies seek landowner approval to survey any proposed route. FERC then engages with the proponent in a pre-filing phase. There is then the formal certificate application filing phase, and then FERC's ultimate decision to either grant or deny a certificate on a specific project.
So this particular section. One of the things on the issue of supply and need, we both on this committee and in the legislature as a whole have been presented with a variety of different findings. One could cite any number of different findings from our regional ISO. We can just as easily cite the most recent findings from the Attorney General's report. Does the department or does your secretariat have anything to add to why we ought to give greater weight to one or the other in this consideration? Because I think they are dense. Certainly, we can be attracted to the ones that we like the policy outcomes of the most. But I think we'd love to hear your perspective on the differences of those greater studies.
Thank you. It's a great question, and one that generates, I think, a tremendous amount of confusion because of the volume of the studies that exist. I forget the number off the top of my head, but I'd say we're probably getting close to a dozen different studies that show that discuss the need for basically supply and demand. Where are we really? And I would say all but one study shows that we need more increased natural gas capacity. And again, going back to those issues of cost, carbon, and reliability, some studies focus more on reliability issues, others focus more closely on cost issues. We are focused on all of the above, cost, carbon, reliability. And counterintuitively, the most dramatic reduction that we can make in a short term by 2020 is the combination of the passage of incremental gas capacity, whether it's from 500 MMCF to closer to one plus BCF, with the addition of the passage of the governor's hydro proposal, would yield the greatest savings not only in cost in meeting our greenhouse gas goals, but also the greatest savings in greenhouse gases, the greatest reduction, because we would become less reliant on that winter reliability program where we have to fire on our less efficient, more costly oil generators. So when you look at the overall dynamic and the overwhelming majority opinion that states we are in desperate need of more natural gas capacity on some level to address our baseline needs, no one else is really focused. We've done our own internal analysis on the greenhouse gas benefits. Some studies point to those. Some ignore the greenhouse gas element of it. But when you look at from a reliability perspective of what the market is developing for new generation sources to provide us with the base load, it's all natural gas. And you look at the opportunity to maximize our greenhouse gas reduction goals, the overwhelming majority of the studies point to some incremental level of gas capacity being needed to meet those goals simultaneously in the most cost-effective way possible. Let me make this really abundantly clear. This is not just about cost. Certainly cost is an integral piece in all of this, but it is that interweb of those three items that I keep hammering on of cost, carbon, and reliability. And simultaneously taking incremental steps forward to address all of those issues in the smartest, most economically responsible way possible. And we feel that given the, to return to your question, going through each gas study and looking at the wide variety of opinions that have been developed, and deferring to the expertise that we have internally in the administration, and working with our partners at the ISO, all opinions point towards the need for more incremental gas capacity on some level. And we can't rely just on the pipes that we have presently. You know, some assumptions have been made that there's full maximum capacity coming down to the maritime pipes from Canada down into New England, when in actuality they're only running at 25% capacity, soon to be completely shut off. We have a changing dynamic. We can't become over-reliant on the LNG international markets, because in 2013, 2014, that winter, where we saw the dramatic price spikes that every ratepayer, from low-income ratepayer to the richest of the rich, felt, we paid the highest spot price for LNG in the entire world in our ports in New England. So to become reliant on that international market to balance our energy needs is an economically irresponsible approach to do it solely in that regard. Will energy efficiency play a role? You betcha, and I can't wait to get into this slide. Will renewables play a role? Will solar? You bet. Will onshore wind? Yes. Could potentially offshore wind? I just opened up that can of worms for you, Senator. You bet. It all will play a role. But it's a question of how much, not too soon in any one direction, to just completely blow up our markets, to completely have such a detrimental effect to our employers throughout the Commonwealth, that we need to find that right balance of doing it in a smart way that gets us to that finish line of a cleaner, more renewable future per the terms of our climate plan that I will discuss towards the end of the presentation. Thank you.
So you're including the net on hydro, because I had asked the administration this question before, and they were going to be including that because they're, you know, it's not a zero carbon emission gain when you're talking about hydroelectricity. But I agree with you, it's significantly lower than other options. So if you look at hydroelectricity, I'm getting a little bit more confused than I was before about where the administration is on this, because what I had been reading in the conversations I had before seemed to indicate the more that we embrace hydro, the more likely it was that the administration would be backing off gas. You know, we don't have any factors in the climate plan for the gas leaks that we have right now under the existing system. You know, that's not factored in.
It's included.
The gas leaks are included. Could we get that data? Because I haven't seen
the plan.
Well, I'd love to see the updated piece on that, and that's great if it is, and if it's accurate. When we look at the AG's report that was just put out not too long ago, the Attorney General will be hearing from the office in a little bit, but they seem to disagree with what you said a few minutes ago. The study cited the support in the pipelines based on, and this is on the AG's report, this is E2. That has submitted this information to us based on faulty assumptions, outdated information, and have many caveats, you know, to get to their outcomes. The recent independent study completed by the Attorney General's office determined that, quote, under existing market conditions, which you just referenced, if we kept things the way they are, there is no electric sector reliability deficiency through 2030, unquote. That's from the AG's report. So here we are, a panel. We've got other, you know, panels that have looked at this. Senator Downey has looked at this for hours and hours and hours and hours, more hours than he wants to count. And we have
not running for re-election.
Yeah,
but
you
driving it, that's it.
But, you know, you look at this and you can see how, you know, lay people that are trying to understand this, you know, get a bit confused when we have a very significant report put out by the Attorney General's office saying exactly the opposite of what you just said, that we don't need additional gas expansion. And then I'm instructed by, and I hate to bring this up because I do bring it up from time to time, and I apologize ahead of time, but I happen to be a little familiar with a country that's more like a state, Portugal. And Portugal now is 60% renewable energy in terms of their generation and meeting their needs. Now, Portugal has about 4 million more people than we have here in the state. There are about 10 million people in the country. A number of years ago, they were closer to 80% dependent on fossil fuels. They embraced, as the governor wants us to, hydro in a big way, but they coupled that with a significant amount of onshore wind, solar, industrial solar, community-based solar, significant amount of work on energy efficiency, and they upgraded a smart grid, the likes of which I have not seen in other areas of our own country here in the U.S. I would ask you please to have somebody take a look at what they've done. Take a look at what Denmark's done. Take a look at what Austria's done. Take a look at what some of the other places in the world that were as much as 90% dependent upon fossil fuels. And they're heading towards being not reliant at all on fossil fuels. You said, Mr. Secretary, that it depends upon the speed. We don't want to go too fast. I want us to go as fast as we can. I want us to go as fast as we can to getting to an outcome that has us be, you know, almost 100% renewable energy. And I know that in your next slides, when you talk about energy efficiency, I think we're going to have a lot more agreement there. But because that's where a lot of it is, we can do a lot in energy efficiency to bring down base load. But I guess we'll wait to hear what the AG has to say on this. But
so what our study found was that when we looked at both costs and at greenhouse gas emissions, the first troubling thing was none of our options under our scenario was going to get us to our global warming solutions. Our Reggie goals, none of them were going to get us to our Reggie goals. So that's something we all need to be thinking about. I mean, no matter what choice, we need to be doing more than what we're currently doing. But in terms of comparison between the options, the best option in terms of how much it would save ratepayers and how its greenhouse gas emission effects was the combination of energy efficiency and demand response. And I wanted to talk a little bit about that further because I hear the Secretary on what he's saying about, wait a minute, is that really realistic to say, oh, you know, we're working so hard to get to the energy efficiency that we're doing right now, really can we take on more? And so we thought about that, and the solution, the option that we looked at consists of 1,300 megawatts of incremental winter peak energy efficiency plus 1,100 megawatts of demand response. So that was sort of the package that we were looking at. And it was designed specifically to meet this deficiency, which, as you recall, is small. It's 26 hours in a winter, you know, starting in 2029. So that's our, you know, our report is showing a deficiency not until much later. So we designed all of the options around meeting that potential deficiency. So when they came back with those results, and I said, well, how much energy efficiency would we actually have to do to get to what you're talking about? And our analysis showed that we would need a 1.1 further reduction than what we're already doing on top of the current energy efficiency goals for that are in our 3-year plan. In addition, the rest of the region would have to get on board with a significant amount of new energy efficiency. But it's true that we are number one in the country. But have we, look at other countries. I mean, when you look at, there was a study done by the American Council for Energy Efficient Economy. They did a report, and they ranked the United States 13th out of 16 of the leading economies in energy efficiency. We're behind all of Europe. Right now, the vast majority of buildings in Massachusetts don't undertake energy efficiency measures. There's a tremendous potential for demand response that we're not tapping. So what we're saying is, we get it that we're all working really hard on energy efficiency, but what would it look like to double down and try to figure out what does the next world of energy efficiency look like? What other things can we learn from other places that we could really take on an additional investment in energy efficiency? Energy efficiency reduces costs for our customers in their own homes, in their own pocketbook, and it reduces greenhouse gas emissions. I think that one interesting thing to think about is the recent forward capacity auction, which sort of played out our business as usual circumstance. So the new forward capacity auction looked for 3 years out down the road, what are we gonna need to, in terms of generation, to keep the lights on. And the results came in way above the need. Lots of extra capacity is out there. And that included the retirement of Pilgrim. And what happened was there was a price signal, and people came in and they bid in new dual fuel power plants. There's some renewable, about 100 megawatts of renewable in that. But a lot of it, dual fuel gas-fired power plants. So it is playing out, the market is playing out as we expected. But in order for us to meet all of our goals, we're gonna